So today's session topic is why bad things happen to good people. This is a humble presentation from both of us, Her Grace Govindanandini Mataji and myself. This is a very familiar and very popular topic, and it is very common to get this question at certain point of time in our lives. Why do bad things happen to the good people? It's quite natural, right? How much we are practicing any spirituality or any God consciousness, it happens because we are in such a world. So it will make us bewilder. It will make us think like that. And there are so many books written on this topic, particular topic. Why do bad things happening to good people? We are believing in God. Still, why it is happening like that? And in fact, I went through some of these books also. What these books are covering is they are saying that they are able to explain very nicely. And we have to accept it, whatever comes in our life, they are explained very nicely. And they could explain to the extent of, except one book. This Hindi book, it is mentioning about a little bit more detail, which is related to somewhat Bhagavad Gita. Other books, they explain to the extent of loss of nature and God doesn't interfere it in each and every individual case. So today we will go through detailedly what Bhagavad Gita is clearly explaining and giving answer for this particular question. When we seriously think, can you please all of you go on mute? I'm humbly requesting. So really, why? Why it's happening like that? Sometimes we think it's quite natural. So if someone can recite this verse, taking the volunteership, that will be great.
Bhuktaram yagna tapasam sarvaloka maheshwaram suhrudam sarvabhutanam jnatvamam shantim ruchyate.
Yeah, translation also, Mataji.
A person in full consciousness of me, knowing me to be the ultimate beneficiary of all sacrifices and austerities, the supreme lord of all planets and demigods, and the benefactor and all well-wisher of all living entities, attains peace from the pangs of material miseries.
Thank you so much, Mataji. So here it is clearly explained that Supreme Lord is the well-wisher, Suhrut. There is a lot of difference between a Mitra or Suhrut. A Mitra is just, nowadays we will come across so many friends, my most friend, best friend, dearest friend, close friend. How much dear we are in this material world, it is just like scratching your back, you scratch my back. That's it. So at one point of time, they will expect something from us. Whereas the Supreme Lord, he is not expecting anything from us and he wants to do something good for us. He is the well-wisher of all of us. No matter what, how degraded we are, he is so merciful and he is the best well-wisher. And he is the closest friend than any of our closest relative in our home, either life partner or mother, father, home. He is the closest person than anyone else because he is residing in our own heart only. But still, even such a great friend is very close to us. Why these bad things are happening to the good people? Because Lord is residing in every living entity's heart. So why still all these are all happening is the today's topic. So, is that raising the question, is God that cruel? Because we are seeing sometimes so many nice people. Even sometimes we are thinking devotees all of a sudden facing some issue. So, is really God cruel for letting all this happen like this? in Srimad Bhagavatam, Lord Brahma is saying regarding this, tattenu kampamsa simikshamano punjana eva atmakrutam vipakam rutpakvapurvir vidatan namaste jivetayo mukti pade sadaya bhag. Here Brahma is explaining that if anyone has any kinds of sufferings that may arise due to the past misdeeds, if such a soul is completely depending on the Lord's mercy and continuing depending on the Lord within his heart, for such a person, spiritual dham will be inherited to such a person. He will be qualified to that extent. So Brahma is saying to all us that it will happen by any reason, whatever the reason may be. If we are in that painful situation also, if we are holding the lotus feet of the Lord, we can be eligible to the liberation very easily. So how it is happening, how it is possible, also we will say here. So here, when we are thinking that it is happening, why it is happening, why it is happening, when we go behind the reasons, God is there. We are seeing in a limited picture. Only this lifetime we are seeing. We don't know the past life, future life, what is the eternal existence, what we are going through. So, but Lord, he is looking in the top view, not in the front view or back view or anything. He is looking us at the top view. Bird's view, it is called as in geometry. So, when he is looking the whole picture and observing us millions of lifetimes, he has to take so many decisions. So we will think, seeing one small incident, one small action, reaction, we will be bewildered. So when we talk philosophically, the law of karma exists in each and every category, at each and every step. So suppose when we have taken birth, a child in the womb for the first even not only in the birth, in the womb he will remember the whole past lives, hundreds of past lives, and even after taking birth also up to 3-4 years he can remember the past lives. So, and in the womb the child prays incessantly, please relieve me from this birth and death life cycle. I am totally depending on you only. I cannot bear this womb atmosphere. Please, please, please. Intensely the womb, child in the womb prays so much. And immediately when he comes out, unfortunately, he'll be trapped in the Maya. And the first Maya itself is the mother's Maya. And the minute when everyone is pampering, that's it. He started thinking that I am the king, I am the enjoyer, I am everything. That's how our law of karma for that life period starts counting. So at that time, what will happen? What you sow, so you shall reap. So when we are cultivating the bad habits and we are grown up, this we are pampering this body by the things we will achieve accordingly. If suppose we are accumulating the good qualities, you will get a good life. And when you are accumulating the bad habits and disobedient to the authorities, we will achieve the destiny accordingly. And this law of karma is the infallible justice. We cannot say that it's not fair. Something injustice is happening to me. We cannot say like that. It is the perfect law because it is not designed by the so-called materialistic persons. It is the Lord's design. And when we see the definition of karma, the function and activity of the living entity within the framework of his free will and under the influence of the three modes of material nature over a span of time. So this karma is like Newton's third law. So we have to see the action, we have to perform the actions very carefully. Based on that, we'll have the reaction, and the whole cycle is called as karma, and it is happening in a different span of time. And this karma, what goes around comes around. So sometimes we'll forget about our past lives, right? We will calculate from this lifetime according to our remembrance only. But whatever has been in our hundreds and thousands of lifetime, the karma backs to us, come back to us. In the Nectar of Devotion, it is mentioned that there are so many types of karmas. Prarabdha karma, aprarabdha karma, kutastha karma. There are so many types of karmas. When we will be able to see only matured karmas, but there are so many which are unmatured, and we will see over a period of time all those reactions. Suppose if we are doing in the helping motive, always trying to do some help to others, so that will comes under category of good karma. Suppose if we are irresponsible and ignoring the laws of nature and behaving as ever, whatever we like, this is called you get what you give. Here in this particular picture, right side, it is little bit gross, but please excuse me, I have to explain this. Here, the upstairs person who is spitting on the downside person, he doesn't have any motive to spit on the downside person. But the law of nature is working so beautifully that when he is spitting on someone else's house, the law of nature is playing a role, and it is giving the immediate reaction sometimes like this. So we should not say that we cannot think that nobody is observing me, nobody is noticing me, I can do however I want to behave. We cannot. And some other volunteer, can someone explain what this, seeing this picture, what you can understand? You can guess, anything you can guess.
Entanglement.
Entanglement, very good. Anybody else?
Mess. Like your.
Pardon, Mataji?
Mess as in chaos?
Mess as in chaos. Very good. So it's very nice. So sometimes we cannot understand why everything is happening around us like that, and why it is happening to me only all this. I never did any harm to others. So there are so many chaos in our mind happening around when we don't understand the things what it is. So, but there will be a perfect design behind every action of the Lord. Initially, we may not understand what it is, but when we patiently taking time, so we will see the incidents were exactly placed. Yes, this is correct. Now I am able to understand. Because of that incident only, I am able to grow. Because of that incident only, I am right now, I am like this. So when we see the life history of Srila Prabhupada, how much he went through. He did not do anything. He was requesting everyone to help. It was trying to convince his wife, his family members, everyone. And he is struggling so hard, but no one, government is not cooperating, neighbors are not cooperating. But it is such a bewildering situation, because Prabhupada tolerantly went through all that. We can see a perfect design, and we are able to take those results of this nice Krishna consciousness. Like that, everything happens like that to us, to each and every one of us. Only thing is, we have to wait patiently and tolerantly. And we should never judge by appearance. And we should not compare our results with others. Sometimes we cannot judge properly. In this picture, if the rabbit compares herself that seeing the external bush of the carrot, and if she upset, it doesn't make any sense. So we have to have complete faith in the Lord. Lord is the best well-wisher. No matter whatever happens, maybe for temporarily it is happening like this, but definitely he doesn't do any harm for me. He will reveal. Only thing is, I am not understanding the current situation. So the devotee will think like this. He never thinks that a devotee, so-called bad or good, or he cannot think like that. He will be equipoised with everything. Even in the materialistic terms, we think that suppose good is happening now, bad is happening now, and means it is like we are spending the bad karma of us. Suppose we are facing some calamities, any negativities, any reversals in our lives, means we should understand that we already saw, right, bad karma, good karma. When we are helping others, when we are doing good for others, that comes as the good karma. When we are troubling others, when we are ignoring the laws of nature, it is coming as the bad karma. So like credit card and debit card, always bad karma, good karma, both will be accumulated in our bank account. Our karma, there is a karma bank in our lives. So both will be there. They cannot be nullified with each other. If suppose I am doing good karma, this bad karma will erase if I do good karma. No, nothing like that. Good karma and bad karma, both are separate accounts. How they will be utilized means, when we are going through some enjoyment, so-called materialistic happiness, when we are thinking that I have a good job, good luxury, bench car, very costly house, when we are enjoying all that, means we should understand that we are clearing out our good karma balance. And when we are facing any calamities, depressions and negatives, reversals in our life, that means our bad karma is erasing. That means it is, technically it is good. We are balancing it. We are nullifying our bad karma. So in either way, when we are facing calamities, we don't need to be depressed. We don't need to be worried at all. And thinking about the spiritual terms, how the devotee thinks means, I haven't brought anything when I'm coming. Everything is given by the Lord. Everything is Lord's mercy. If so-called, talking as the materialistic terms, so-called good is happening to the devotee, how he is thinking means, actually I am not destined to receive this much good position. But because I am depending on Krishna, he is showing mercy and he is giving me. It is Lord's mercy only. And when he is undergoing through some calamities, he will think that actually Krishna is so merciful, I would have gone through a lot of damage. Instead of that, Lord is helping me by reducing it to a small pain or cut or wound. There is a realistic example. It's not just a philosophy. During 1970s, late 1970s, when there were bomb blasts in the Mayapur, there was one Maharaj. His name is Bhakti Raghava Maharaj. And in those days, it is not difficult as everything well sophisticated right now. In those days, the devotees went through a lot of situations, and there were a lot of issues, problems caused by the Muslims, local Muslims there. And they went up to to the extent they threw the bombs also onto the devotees. So at that time, Bhakti Raghava Maharaj and Nityananda Maharaj, there are a few devotees present in the temple premises. So they immediately came out to fight against these people, Muslims. So at that time, the bomb immediately fell on the Bhakti Raghava Maharaj. He, with the power of that bomb, he flew and fell down so many feet away. And in that incident, he lost his right leg. And if you see, he doesn't have the right leg. And at that point of time, when he came to consciousness, he said his realization, he was not thinking of anything else, just saying loudly, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. And after coming to consciousness, he was extremely happy. Why? Because he lost the leg, which is polio, which had the polio. It is already damaged. See, Lord's mercy, because of the Lord's mercy, I did not lose my good leg. Anyway, my other leg is not useful for me. So it is the Lord's mercy. So the devotees will think like that, will feel like that. They are so exalted. We should, after all, whatever we are thinking the so-called problems as, like losing the job, having some pain, or some financial problems, they are nothing compared to this kind of problems. So we should not be depressed when so-called bad things are happening. Why I am getting all this? Why it is happening to me? No, nothing like that. All these are all the Lord's mercy to teach us something. We should, and the devotee always thinks that, Lord, I know your plans. There is something good happening to me. Please give me tolerance to go through all these phases. Like that, the devotees will pray. And when we, okay, it is some, we are meeting the materialistic people, they don't understand this much philosophy and they cannot have this much surrenderance when we are trying to explain. Suppose our moms who are not in Krishna consciousness, no, my everything will be all right. This is for our good only. You just chant Hare Krishna means no. Lord means why he has to give me this problem? Why I have to go through? When we are, in my personal case itself, when I'm trying to say that, no, these are all the phases, you will get something good, don't worry. No, why I have to go through, first of all, when I'm believing the God, why I have to face this situation? Why I have to went up to the surgery? So their faith will be bewildered. No, the actual reality is, every action has an appropriate reaction. If someone is charitable, in the next birth, he will be very wealthy. Or if we are harming others, or we are thinking that harming others means only killing someone or something like that. But when we are doing the suffering means, it should not be by the words, it should not be by the actions, it should not be by our attitude. Mm-hmm. So, mind, words, body, they'll say, right, BMW. Body, mind and words. We should not hurt anybody, any living entity. If we do like that, karma reaction will be with us. So, we have to be ready to face through this. And can someone else read this verse? Bhagavad Gita 4.17.
कर्मणो हि अपि बोद्धव्यं बोद्धव्यं च विकर्मणः अकर्मणश्च बोद्धव्यं गहना कर्मणो गतिः. Translation: the intricacies of action are very hard to understand. Therefore, one should know properly what action is, what forbidden action is, and what inaction is. Prabhupada ji.
Yeah, very nice. Thank you very much, Prabhuji. So it is very difficult to understand actions and reactions, this karma philosophy. It is very difficult to understand and very difficult to overcome. So, but we can take the help of the Bhagavad Gita to know what kind of actions we are doing and what category it comes under. It is the overview of our actions, how it will be categorized according to the Bhagavad Gita. So there are three types of actions. One is karma, doing the right things according to the religious principles or Vedic principles. And the second one is the vikarma, performing detrimental acts, that means ignoring the religious principles and knowingly going against the religious principles. And the third one is the akarma, activities which help us break this repeated cycle of birth and death. So we should verify ourselves, whatever action we are performing, is it according to the religious principles or not? Is it according to mode of goodness or not? Okay, how can I know what it is, a religious principle or not? So that's the reason we have to go through this Bhagavad Gita. In the Bhagavad Gita, from beginning to end, what kind of food we have to eat, what kind of living style we have to go through, what kind of charity we should do. Everything it is given to know this karma, what and all will come under the karma. We will be the speculating. Yes, this is good. I am giving 10 rupees to a beggar. It is good karma. Definitely, there will be a good karma credited in my account. They don't know when that beggar go and drink any alcohol or go and eat any meat. They don't know anything. And we are speculating and assuming that we are doing good karma, good to others, helping the others. No, we have to go through the religious Vedic scriptures, then only we should confirm it is the proper action. Next is the vikarma. See, nowadays, if we are trying to preach in India, this is the problem. When we are saying something good, they'll say, I know everything. I know all these. I know Krishna. From childhood, I am doing. I know Bhagavad Gita. I know everything. So this is the problem. And it is said that Bharat Bhumi is the Punya Bhumi. It's the very pious land. And knowingly, we are ignoring all these principles. And there are so many pastimes, knowingly also they have done, like Ajamila, like in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Jagai and Madai. They know everything. They are the nice Brahmanas. Knowingly they want to do the against the Vedic principles, so Vedic scriptures. So these are all coming under the vikarma. And nowadays, it's becoming a fashion to follow the other idiot. And thinking that the other idiot will behave that he is so nice, he is so posh, so he is so advanced. And everyone is facing this situation, especially current generations. Blind following the blind. Prabhupada used to quote this. They are led by the blind people, and blindfully they are, all our kids, they're also following those so-called fashions, hairstyles, everything. So these are all, we have to try to educate them. Next, because of this karma and vikarma, we have to go through so many action and reactions and consequences, either fructify or prarabdha karma, prarabdha karma, now or later, someday other, we have to go through all these situations. So how we can stop all these means? By performing the akarma, by following the scriptures. Here, if you see, the devotees are offering food, whatever they are cooking, to the Lord and eating, whereas the non-devotees, they are eating for their sense gratification. This is the example, best example. What is the vikarma? What is the akarma? So to nullify all our actions and reactions, we have to offer everything. Yat karoshi yadasnasi yat juhoshi dadasi yat. We say, right? So we have to offer everything to Krishna, and then we have to take the results. That is karma yoga, it is mentioned. And ignorance of law is no excuse. We cannot say that I don't know that. If I don't know, why I have to face all these. No. Krishna, when we are sending itself, he is the well-wisher, best well-wisher. Not I said. Bhagavad Gita said, right? He is the best well-wisher of all of us. So before sending us, even though he doesn't want to send us to this material world, before sending us, he provided everything how to come out of it also. So one of such kind of facilities is the Bhagavad Gita. and our scripture Srimad Bhagavatam Chaitanya Charitamrita. If we read that and if we read that manual and if we come out of it, then only we can go come out of this birth, death, life cycle and this material world. If we say that I don't know means we have to face. Otherwise, even how much great we are because of our karma, we can become a beggar like Indra becoming a pig in the next life. So, and we will be thinking that life is better, that life is best. I have my family like that. Every one of us should think when we ignore this loss. And from the pastime of Ajamila, we can understand, we can learn a lot. All the action, karma, akarma, karma, vikarma, akarma, all three are there in this Ajamila pastime. I'm not going into the brief. So in the childhood onwards, he is a nice Brahmana. He knows everything. He adopted all the Brahminical qualities. But due to the bad association, he started performing all the vikarma activities. And finally, with the mercy of the Lord and the with his Ajnana Sukriti, he performed an akarma action and Lord mercifully gave him another chance to become a nice devotee. So we should not take the risk of Ajamila lifetime and go through all that. Intelligently, we have to follow at every step all akarma activities only. So benefits of such kind of spiritual actions are, it eradicates all material reactions. You suppose in the Damodar month, it is said that when you offer a ghee lamb to the Lord, even Mount Meru quantity of sins also will be nullified by just offering a ghee lamb. And when we are performing ekadasis, when we are doing the devotional services, just if you go to temple and smell the incense, and if you do the Mangalarati, if you see the Mangalarati, so all these are all the clearing actions. But it doesn't mean that we should accumulate again. No, we have to continue these spiritual actions and uproot our ignorance. Otherwise, Abrahma Bhuvana Loka Punaravattinojna Mamukrityat Kauntaya Punajanma Navidyati. So we have to go again and again in this life cycle. Only when we take shelter of Krishna only, we can come out of this birth, death, life cycle. And we can go back to his kingdom. Okay, I'll give a small gap here. Any questions? So far, on the law of karma.
Hare Krishna Mataji, thank you so much for karma and vikarma karma. So I have like some doubt. One of my friends, he wants to give charity so many ways, like clothes, old clothes or shoes, some food and all. That is good karma, right? So we can't tell them to not give, like you can go to the scriptures, don't do like this. Like you gave example for we can give any beggar to $10. So what they can do, we don't know. But in the he can't give the money, but he can give some ways, right? So we can tell it's good. So in that situation, we can encourage them to them. So very how nice. Can we?
Yeah, very nice, Mataji. Usually, devotees, what they will do, it is very detailedly explained in the 17th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Mataji, about the charity. You go through and your questions, so many will be clarified. And for your question, usually devotees will offer whatever they get, whatever they buy, any clothes, anything they will offer to Krishna. So then it will be a prasadam, even clothes, even food, anything, it will be a prasadam. You can give that, but not, it is not recommended, not any torn clothes or anything, it is not recommended. And even though it is hard to digest, when you are not offering to Krishna and when you are giving, thinking that it is the mode of goodness, there will be karma involved, Mataji. There will be bondage between you and that person or your friend or that person. And karma philosophy is very strict. If he takes something, he has to give back to you something, either this lifetime or next next lifetime. So anything which is offered to Krishna, you can give that prasadam to others. Whether if it is not offered, there will be karma involved in it, and we have okay, thank you so much. We'll go to the next topic.
Krishna Mataji, sorry to interrupt. I have a question on one of the slides that you went over.
Okay.
For when you mentioned that if someone turns away from Krishna, and the one that was mentioning about dogs and cats, about the philosophy, it's not for dogs and cats, it's for human beings to absorb and surrender their life to. It was a red colored slide. So at the end of the slide, you said for the ones that don't accept the philosophy, they are punished. So did you mean that they suffer the consequences accordingly to the karmic reaction, or did you mean they get punished for not accepting the spirituality and their duty?
In both the cases, they have to suffer the consequences, Mataji. One is knowingly when we are not following, and the other one is ignoring it. Both has no excuse. We have to go through the reaction.
Thank you. I just wanted to confirm if it was suffering consequences or if it was punishable.
And I'm very sorry. Some facts will be hard to digest, but we have to accept it. And there is a wonderful remedy for all of these. I will tell at the end of the session. Okay?
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Okay, we'll go to the reincarnation topic immediately. And when we are going with this karma and akarma, karma and vikarma, right? So this action and reaction, they will be accumulated, pile up in our bank account, karma bank account. So what will happen? As long as we have this body, we will go through all these pains, sufferings, happiness, miseries, everything. So when we are leaving this body, what will happen? So we cannot escape again. Some ignorant people, they'll commit suicide ignoring this fact. They'll think that by killing this body, they are thinking that my karma will be nullified. In the next life, I'll be free of everything. No, it's not like that. When that is what reincarnation is explaining, and why we have to, how we have to go through all this, we will see. So it is the very popular picture of reincarnation. So what is reincarnation? Why does it happen? What is reincarnated? How long you have to wait between the births? Does it happen to all of us or only a few? And again, it is a very vast topic. I cannot discuss that much detail from all the Puranas, based on all the Puranas. So I'll just mainly focus according to the Bhagavad Gita for time being. We have only 80 minutes time. Okay. So a process by which a soul transmigrates from one body to another is known as the reincarnation. So we are all familiar from childhood. We know that previous life is there, next life will be there. So we are all familiar with this reincarnation term. And why it happens? By the laws of karma and under the direction of Paramatma, the living entity reincarnates in a body just suitable to the mentality, a change we commonly call as birth. So Paramatma is noticing everything, whatever our thoughts, whatever our deeds, everything he has, he's noticing, like the two birds, right? In our second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, we read, one bird is doing the actions, making plans, and the other bird is just observing. So the Paramatma and our laws of karma will decide what kind of body, what kind of life we are going to have in the next life. Suppose our mental thinking is so much aggressive, so much thinking of wildly, then we can have the chance of taking the lion's body. Otherwise, we are sleeping too much per day, 12 hours, 13 hours. We feel like sleeping. We like sleeping. I love sleeping, people used to say. So we'll have that groundhog body or bear's body. So some people like to be chilled like that. So depending on our interests, desires, thoughts, willingness, we'll have. And Krishna is so nice. He doesn't interfere in our free will, right? So he will search among 8.4 million species according to our desires, what body is suitable for us. He will nicely grant for us. So you may ask the question, it is my karma and my mind, my subtle body is the one deciding everything to go to the other body. Then what is the need of Lord? No. If our American president or Indian prime minister is there, whatever it is there, even though they are the highest authority, they will take the approval of the government or the authorities. They cannot go as the one man show. In the same way, even the mind, our consciousness, our desires, there should be approval from the Supreme Lord. Even the material nature also, even the demigods also, everyone has to take the permission, and the Supreme Lord is the grantor of everything. If we can please Krishna by any pious activity or any devotional service, everything can be changed. I will tell later. Okay, this reincarnation is believed by so many holy people, religious organizations or religions, Buddhism, they believe in this reincarnation. Jewish people, they believe in reincarnation. Although in Christianity or Islamism, they don't know. But even many of their scriptural quotes are mentioning that there is reincarnation mentioned in the Bible also or Quran also. So it is unanimously approved that there is a past life and there is this traveling of soul from one body to another. It is there just like changing our dresses. And there are so many scientific researches are going on to prove this, but they cannot prove because these are all the subtle laws of nature, but they can study and they can come to some conclusions, positive conclusions, confirming that yes, there is a lot of possibilities for this transformation, for this reincarnation. Like that, there is one popular scientist, his name is Ian Stevenson. His whole life he dedicated to study on this reincarnations and past lives. And he alone studied 3,000 cases and more than 2,500 cases. Still, they have been published and still they are available in the Division of Perceptual Studies at the University of Virginia, United States. He found, based on the facts, usually they used to collect these facts between the 5 to 10 years. Because at that age only they used to start talking and they will clearly explaining, right? Usually from 3 to 5 years, whatever the facts they are mentioning, it is coming very truthful. It is proved as factual. So they did so many studies and they confirmed that 300 cases were so exact. 80 to 90% were accurate, 300 cases. So they came to the conclusion and... if you see Buddhism, there is a, even though they're more, their objective is Nirvana, Buddhists, but they believe in this reincarnation. And they say that if the soul is, they don't believe in the soul concept, but they say that this rebirth will be happening according to the energy of the body. They believe in the energy of the body, but they don't believe in the soul. But whatever it is, their conception, but they believe in the reincarnation. They say that if the energy is still hankering, clinging to the current body, they will take the rebirth. And there are so many evidences. It is mentioned in the Bible, Quran. If anyone wants any references, I can forward it later. So... okay, I'm believing in reincarnation. How can we break? How can we free from this cycle of reincarnation? Because it is not easy to go through these 6 phases of our life. Birth, death, old age, disease, and in between dwindling and reproduction. All these are all not easy. When a baby is staying in the womb, it is a hell in the mother's womb itself. So drinking the same excretions smelling the same. So it is Antakopa. Again, there are so many hells it is mentioned in the scriptures, right? 84 lakhs of hells are there. Out of the 21 deepest hells are there. So it is one of that. Mother's womb is also that kind of. So it is, when we are having these diseases, pains, just after all, we have a tooth pain itself. In one of the classes, Amritanand Prabhuji is mentioning about his tooth pain. So how horrible it is. So all these phases, birth, death, old age, disease, it is so horrible. But when we are ignoring these laws and going on with this cycle, we have to go through. So how to, at one point at least, taking this human life, we other living entities, they cannot think. At least we have to be happy to think at this point, how can I break this reincarnation cycle? This, one of the solutions is by spiritual evolution. We are accepting human body, we are going to the lower forms, right? So, many yogis, Brahma Vaivarta Purana is saying that after 8.4 million species of lives only, we can have the chance to take the shelter of lotus feet of Krishna or Govinda. So, knowing the importance of that, one should inquire about God seriously. There are so many illusions. In this Kali Yuga especially, our smartphone itself is the biggest maya in our hands, very close to us. So, we have to be very, very strong, realized persons, and we should think about Krishna. So these yogis, there are so many yogis, Brahmagnanis, they know these, they are not bodies, they are soul, and they will try for millions of years to come out of this birth, death, life cycle. They are trying to attain moksha in various means. But the easiest means is, as Krishna said, simply by devotional service, by performing akarma activities, we can break this birth, death, life cycle. Just one or two questions before going to the next topic. I'm very sorry, I'm not able to give. I'll give the, at the end, full time. If anyone has one or two questions.
So Mataji, like reincarnation and rebirth, both are same, right?
Yes, Mataji.
So why you call, like, why we are called, like, in Krishna is coming any, like Narasimha Dev or Rama or any incarnation, we are called incarnations. For living entities, we are going rebirth.
Yeah. Because the body is considered as the temple. And Paramatma is also traveling with us. We are not alone always. So we will be called as this, because the Paramatma is residing in us, we call this birth as the reincarnation. And in the materialistic terms, you can call as the rebirth. Okay?
Okay, thank you, Mataji.
Okay, Hare Krishna. I'm trying to make it slideshow. I'm not able to do. I don't know what I'm doing. So, we know that karma, akarma and vikarma, right? But knowingly, why we are behaving like that? Sometimes our mind is not in our control. Our actions are not in our control. Even though we want to do akarma activities, devotional activities, something is pulling us into the maya. What is that something? Why? What we have to be aware of? What else we need to be conscious of? Is this is the main most important factor, that is modes in material existence. When we are sent into this material world, we have to study about this material world. It is, we are living in this kind of life. We are living in with those modes. We are living our lives. So those are the modes passion, goodness, passion, and ignorance. So why do we certain type of action of karma? Why we are performing like that? And what is controlling us? And this, if you see, there are three arrows that are always controlling us. We'll see. And we are puppet in that hand. What is that? What it is making us binding to this material world. So they are their ropes. So as we have a power button, the minute we are getting up in the morning, performing our duty, all these more goodness, passion, ignorance, they will fight and compete with each other. I want to be dominant. I want to be dominant. I want to be dominant. That's why when we are performing in the daytime, early morning, it is prescribed because the mode of goodness will be the prominent. And afternoon time, mode of passion will be prominent. But in the night, the mode of ignorance will be prominent. But it need not be necessarily always like that. But usually it will happen like that. Okay. So whatever it is, all these three tightly form as a strong rope and bind us. The only duty of these three modes is binding us to this material world. And when we are again, it is mentioned nicely in the Bhagavad Gita about these three modes. That someone else, can someone is ready to read this verse?
Sattvam rajastamaiti guna prakriti sambhava nibaddhan. Nibadnanti Mahabaho Dehe Dehinam Avyayam.
Yeah, please go through the translation.
Material nature consists of three modes: goodness, passion, and ignorance. When the eternal living entity comes in contact with nature, O mighty armed Arjuna, he becomes conditioned by these modes.
So we will be conditioned. And our hands are tied. We cannot relieve ourselves. And because of three modes, we will see the world through those glasses only. It's like glasses. If suppose you are wearing a green glasses, we will see the whole world as the green in color. Blue glasses, we will see in blue color. Red glasses in red color. In the same way, if we are in the mode of goodness, we will see everything in the mode of goodness. If we are passion, our mind is passion, we will see everything is in passion mode. If we are ignorance, we will think that everyone is ignorant. So we should understand that if we are finding someone is doing mistake and someone is wrong, means that means we have to verify ourselves first, what mode we are in. And one time I read the Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj article, very nice article. It's like our mentality is like the juice of a fruit. If we are squeezing orange, we will get the orange juice. If we are squeezing a mango, we'll get the mango juice. That means if we are talking anything positive, means we are with the positive quality. If we are finding anything negative, means we are with the negative quality. That's what it is saying that. So always better be in the transcendental mode. Okay, these goodness, passion, and ignorance are like primary colors, blue, red, yellow, right? So, and by the combination of these, we can produce millions of colors. In the same way, by the combination of these goodness, passion, and ignorance, we can create so many moods, unlimited moods. Sometimes we'll be cranky, sometimes we'll be enthusiastic, sometimes we'll be dull, sometimes we'll have spirituality, but spirituality doesn't come under the moods. Okay, these are all the various modes we will have based on combination of these three. See, here if we see, some people are harming others, some people are so much craving for the competition, and some people are in the mode of goodness, and some people are trying to help others, some people are snatching others' property, or passionate of earning something more and more. So again, these are all the goodness. And if you see the symptoms, the goodness person, he will be always pleasant, calm, and equipoised. And he will be always knowledgeable, and he is having the happiness. He will be happy, really happy only. And he will be, the topmost stage is the Brahman stage. Brahma Bhuta Prasannatma. He is always peaceful if the person is in mood of goodness. Next comes the passion. What are the symptoms of the passion person? Wants to enjoy the life, wants to earn money, want more, always having, desiring more targets. So always wants to hanker for something else. Like the kid's mind, it will not be calm, right? Always passionate about or enjoying or eating something. Always engagement. Mind needs engagement in the mood of passion. And never satisfied. Okay, today whatever he wants, he gets. No, now he will be peaceful. He will not desire anything. No, not like that. Immediately he will desire for something else. And symptoms of the person. All illicit activities and being more lazy, dull, indolence, all these are all the, and the behavior is also weird. It will, if we are seeing the Bhagavad Gita 16th chapter, demonic nature, devotee nature, we will see all these qualities, how they will behave. They are, in the Bhagavad Gita, it is mentioned that there is no use of such kind of persons for themselves or for the society. So they will harm themselves and they will harm others also. So these are all the various activities. And why the, how the living entity, when they are subjected to all these, suppose ignorance, passion, goodness, when he is going through, the perceptions, the thinking way, everything will be like that. And emotions, from the perceptions, emotions will arise. And then here comes vikarma and karma, actions and responses. So for all our actions, in the third rectangle, if you say, for all our actions, these are all the causes. Our modes, ignorance, what association we are taking. Depending on the association we are taking, our perception will be there, our emotions will be there, which will take the form of actions. And then it will be the karma account balance will start, and then reactions will start, and material benefits, sufferings, entanglement, again, the reincarnation, the living entity will take birth. Whereas there is one more line, if you see actions and responses, if the, by the mercy of any devotee or spiritual master or any of our pious karma, if we come perform the akarma activities, there is a orange square, akarma activities, there is a detour path which will lead to the, which will make us accumulate the spiritual credits, merits and bliss, and we will have the chance of self-realization, and we can break this, all these life cycles. And in Bhagavad Gita, it was mentioned, Traikunya Vishaya Veda Nistraikunyo Bhavajuna Nitvanvo Nitya Satvasto Niryoga Kshema Atmavan. The Vedas deal mainly with the subject of these three modes of material nature. O Arjuna, become transcendental to these three modes. Be free from all dualities and from all anxieties for gain and safety, and be established in the self. So Krishna, after explaining all, about all these three modes, he is giving the key to escape from this material world, from this entanglement. So that is the clue. He is asking us to be transcendental to all these actions and reactions and three modes. Otherwise, We have to, if we are in the mode of goodness, if we leave our body, we have to go to the upper planets. If we are in the mode of, if we leave our body in the mode of passion, we have to take the earthly planets. If we leave our body in the ignorance, we have to take the hellish worlds or the animistic lives, which is very, very, and whatever we take, even if you take the demigod body like Indra, Chandra, Brahma, Surya, anything, again, it is like jail only. That is the first class jail, B class jail, C class jail. But it is not the solution. It is not liberating us. We have to fall down again to take birth. So only thing, only solution is to be transcendental. Otherwise, we cannot escape this jail. It is very, very difficult. And that stage, it is called as 100% pure goodness. The transcendental stage is called as the pure goodness, which is beyond all these materialistic planets. And here is the conclusion. So, if we follow the instructions of Lord Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita, Avasya Rakshibe Krishna, Vishwasha Palana, we should be completely faithful on the instructions and the Bhagavad Gita, then always, even though we cannot understand for the time being, Avashya Rakshve Krishna. Krishna will be there always to protect us. It is mentioned by Bhaktivinoda Thakur, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur in his Sharanagati. So if we faithfully surrender unto the lotus feet of Lord Krishna, even though any reversals, we don't need to suffer. And he is our father, mother, relative, friend, everything. And sometimes mother slaps us, but he embraces at the end. In the same way, to teach us certain things, sometimes Krishna slaps us. But if we lose his lotus feet and go in attracted to the Maya, we'll be the losers. And in conclusion, what I want to say is, in this material world, there are two ways. One is a rope, another is a Ferris wheel, which is full of lights, music, everything, so tempting. It's up to us to choose the rope of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and go back to Godhead, or to be attracted to this wheel and get into that. So it will be so attractive, but if we get into that Ferris wheel, there is no end. It is very, very hard. At least now, because of Lord Chaitanya's mercy, it is very easily we are understanding and directly we are taking the shelter of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. Otherwise, and to know that Krishna's supremacy itself, it will take millions of lifetimes. Many yogis, jnanis, they are thinking, who is supreme? This God, that God, out of 33 crores of gods. Yesterday, Simhasadas Prabhuji and Gopikant Prabhuji are discussing, right? Like that, they were all yogis are speculating, this God, that God. But because of Lord Chaitanya's mercy, we are directly knowing that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. And if we can make perfect these lives, very easily we can go back to Godhead. So it's all up to us to worship the lotus feet of the Lord without thinking of anything else. Okay, Hare Krishna, thank you very much for your attention. Your questions are welcome. For 1 minute, I can take one or two questions because Govindanandini Mataji has to continue.
Mataji, I have a question. Hare Krishna, Mataji. This is a very nice explanation from you. Thank you so much, Father Mataji. So the question is like, you said like earning money to some extent becoming a patient, correct? Like as I see in the slide as well, right? So what is the thin line of distinction that separates earning money out of goodness and earning money out of patient?
Good. Thank you very much, Prabhuji, for asking. Goodness means whatever we need for our livelihood, earning, there is nothing wrong. Even Rupa Goswami, his whatever earning he has done, he used to distribute 25% for his personal expenses, 25% for medical expenses, 25% for his relatives, 25% for Krishna. So, and he was the Grihastha. He showed us the role as the role model how to lead a life as the Grihastha. So, where the passion comes means, even though we have enough, hankering and trying to spend much of our time and consciousness to earn more and more, more luxurious, more. There is no end point for that. That will be the mode of passion. We should be cautious. But there is one akarma. What we can do is, I say, thank you so much. Now I will say, how we can means, we have to purify our consciousness, use everything in the consciousness of Krishna. Suppose you are going to the office, think that I should earn nicely so that I can give good education to my kids. I can place Krishna as, I can make a good temple, my home as a temple for Krishna. You have to be in the conscious and keep the Krishna in the center. It will not be considered as the passion or goodness. It will be transcendental slowly. But Krishna knows what we are doing, what we are thinking. So slowly, it is a gradual process. Devotional service is a gradual process. But when we trying to adopt this kind of mentality and consciousness, definitely you will see a positive vibration, and slowly you can go closer to Krishna, and you will not have interest to accumulate. You will feel like donate. You will feel do the charity to for the worship of the Krishna. That will be very nice. You will be really happy. Then we are spending for ourselves in the passion.
Thank you very much, Mataji.
Okay, I'm giving the control to Govindanandini Mataji. Thank you so much, Panchakal.
Thank you very much, Hare Krishna. Thank you very much, Kalindi, Gopikanta, Priya Mataji, for a wonderful enlightenment. I thank you very much for all the audience, all the devotees. I pay humble obeisances to all of you for being with us all these evenings for wonderful seminar on the science of self-realization. I appreciate your time and your interest. And I thank the ICNG Temple for arranging this wonderful program and giving me the opportunity to be a part of this in some way, small way. So I would like to begin by offering prayers to Srila Prabhupada. Om Adhyana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Vanchakalpatarubhyascha kripasindhubhya eva cha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhaktavrinda. Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. I have a PowerPoint as well that is very attractive in our Zoom medium to keep our attention and our focus. So I will share that in a few minutes. Before that, I just wanted to glorify the Bhagavad Gita as it is that Srila Prabhupada has done in the beginning, in the introduction. I hope that most of us have gone through the introduction and we know these verses. They are from Gita Mahatmya, and just I'm going to read two verses from there because they relate to our discussion. Especially for today. And the first one is that Gita Shastram Idam Punyam Yapathet Pratapuman Bhaya Shogadi Varjitaha. So Srila Prabhupada mentions that if one properly follows the instructions of Bhagavad Gita, one can be freed from all miseries and anxieties of life. I think that's our major topic today. And I thought this is very relevant to know what Srila Prabhupada brings in terms of Gita glorification, that if we follow the instructions, we can be freed from the miseries and anxieties of life. And the other one, which is the next verse, is that Gita Dhyayana, शीलस्य प्राणायाम परस्य च नैव सन्ति हि पापानि पूर्वजन्म कृतानि च. If one reads Bhagavad Gita very sincerely and with all seriousness, then by the grace of the Lord, the reactions of his past misdeeds will not act upon him. So this is the glorification on this occasion of Gita Jayanti celebration. And I would like to share a small PowerPoint. As I speak, we will look at the PowerPoint just like Mataji did. And here I go. I will. So here I offer my humble obeisances again to Srila Prabhupada. Namo Mishra Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimade Bhakti Vedanta Swamini Namane Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatri Shadani. And I'm more or less trying to cover this particular aspect or theme or aspect in my presentation, why bad things happen to good people. But not just that, but I would like to also throw some light upon and what they do, and when that happens, what do good people do? Because I think that's also interesting to know and to understand and follow. If we can follow that, we'll make our life a little bit easier. So the major topics that I will cover, and I think some of these will a little bit overlap with Mataji, but I hope that they're slightly different also in that sense. You will not be bored again, or you may not say that, oh, this I already considered. So I hope a little bit different I can present. But basically the topics I'm covering is the spiritual evolution in my life, here and now. Art of living and art of dying, in becoming free from karma. And they are all interrelated. So you will see they're not really separately compartmentalized as such, but we'll go through one of each of them as we go along. So just a little recap. Mataji showed this screen already, and I'm bringing it just to remind us as to where we are. So we are basically spiritual souls, part of Krishna, part and parcel, which means eternally and eternally, but eternally separated from Krishna. And we have expressed our desires for enjoyment separate from Krishna. So we are here in this material world accepting the human body, and not just the human body, but we are going from various species of life. So this is our bigger picture, who we are. And this is very deep. This is very described in great detail in the Srimad Bhagavad Gita, especially in the 15th chapter. And these are the verses that really give a very detailed description of exactly what happens to us and how we are moving around in this world. So, Shariram Yadvapnoti Yachapi Utkramati Shvara Bruhitaitvani Sanyati Vayur Gandhan Nivashaya. The living entity in this material world carries his different conceptions of life from one body to another, as the air carries aroma. Thus he takes one body and again quits it to take another. And not just that, but there's also a description of how this body is formed and how it is functioning. Shrotram chakshum sparshanam cha rasanam ghanam eva cha adishthaya manishchayam vishayan upasevate. So the living entity, thus taking another gross body, obtains a certain type of ear, eye, tongue, nose, sense of touch, which are grouped about by the mind. He thus enjoys a particular set of sense objects. So in this world, we are moving and carrying one body to another body, as Mataji reflected upon the reincarnation concept. And it is so subtle that in this verse, it's mentioned that it is not to be seen by our human eyes. And we have experienced that when we experience, sometimes, not always, we have experienced that someone is dying in front of us. And when the person leaves the body, we just don't know. We just know that the person has stopped moving. And that's it, because this carrying of the soul from body to body is so subtle, like air carrying aroma. And we do not see the aroma of the flower, but we know the aroma is there, the flower is there, and in that way it's very subtle. And in this way, this process is going on of quitting the body and taking another body. And every time a soul is encaged and placed in a body, what happens is there's a gross body and there is a subtle body. So we get a particular type of mind and suitable external senses to allow the function, to allow the mind to function. So for example, if a spider's mind works in a particular way and the spider is given a particular type of eye, ear, nose, in order to function according to his mind's desires. And similarly, we as human beings, we are given a very developed mind as compared to all other animals and birds and other species of life, where we are able to have certain very, we can say, evolved thoughts about life, how to enjoy and how to make sense of everything that's given to us. And in order to satisfy the mind, we are also given a body, a human body, which is very highly functional in terms of different activities. So this is a general picture of who we are and who we are in these bodies. Now, as I mentioned before, I'll speak a little bit about the spiritual evolution. And this is the spiritual evolution of the soul in different species of life. As you can see, there are different categories. Starting from the bottom, if you can see, there are aquatics. So that is one type of species of life. And moving on, there are trees, plants, bushes. Moving on, there are worms and germs and reptiles. Moving on, you will see there are birds. And on top of that, there are four-legged animals. And on the very top, there are human beings. So this is explained in the Shastra, in the Vedic literature, and also in the Bhagavad Gita. Srila Prabhupada explains that in great detail, that the soul can occupy a body in any of these categories. And aquatics, trees, or reptiles, or birds, or animals, or human beings. There is a certain amount of evolution every time because the consciousness is moving upwards where there is a higher and higher and higher and higher realization of the body and of the activities of eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. So in every category, there is some amount of evolution for the soul. But I'll go to the next slide. And this is explained in Padma Purana in great detail. Srila Prabhupada gives us this information about the verse. It says, Jalaja Navalakshani Sthavara Laksha Vinchati Krumayo Rudra Sankhyakaha Pakshinam Dashalakshanam Trinshala Lakshani Pashavaha Chatur Lakshani Manushaha. And what this translate is like Jalaja, which is aquatics. There are 900,000 species of Jalaja or aquatics. Sthavara, which is trees, are 2 million species of life. Krumayo, or worms and insects, or reptiles, also in that, are 1.1 million. Pakshi, or birds, are 1 million. Pashu, or four-legged animals, are 3 million species, and finally manav or humans are 400,000 species of life. And as you can see, 8.4 million species of life. And don't think that they are all existing on Earth, because it's explained that these are existing all over the universe in all different various planets. And that's how they are categorized into so many millions of species. We on the Earth experience a very, very few species out of these 8.4 million species of life. But this is a great science, and as it's explained in the Vedas, nobody can prove it wrong and nobody can prove it right. But we take the Shabda Praman, we take the Vedic literature as it is, and we base our understanding on this explanation. What is the difference between these six species, because they are all lined up in the same chart, And we as human beings are just a part of that scheme. So how are we different, or how are we same? So we are same in terms of the body, as I explained before in the previous verse. We, just like any other species of life, have mind. We have eyes, ears, nose, sense of touch, and we have same needs, eating, sleeping, mating, defending. So in that sense, we are not different from any other species of life, just humans as well, just one species of life. But Vedic literature gives a very deep insight about how we are different from other species of life. And this is a very crucial verse. Srila Prabhupada has introduced that verse to us. Ahara nidra abhaya maithunam cha samanam etat pashubhir naranam dharmohi tesham adhiko vishesho dharmena hina pashubhi samana. Eating, sleeping, sex, and defense, these are four principles that are common to both human beings and animals. Difference between human life and animal life is that a man can search after God, but an animal cannot. That is the difference. Therefore, a man without that urge for searching after God is no better than an animal. So in other words, if our life is limited to the activities which any other animals or any other species of life does, then our life is the same as animal life. But the only difference that we have is that we are spiritual. We are spiritual beings. As human beings, we have, they say that we are not human beings in the spirit, experiencing spirituality, but we are spiritual beings experiencing human life. That actually explains exactly who we are. We are spiritual beings, we are spirit souls, but we are experiencing human life. So this is the difference we have. And it's always good, as students of the Gita, we always remember this difference, because then our study of the Gita and taking guidance of the Gita can be very meaningful. Otherwise, we can lose the purpose and not get full benefit of it. So this is the worst, something that we can really memorize always. Now, Mataji showed this picture, I remember, that it's very important. Srila Prabhupada has so much given stress upon the human form of life. As you can see, the evolution of the soul, we saw that chart where we begin, I mean, the lowest point is aquatics, and we have to become trees, we have to become birds, we have to become animals. And at the end, we can become human beings in the evolution of the soul. So one attains the human form of life after transmigrating through 8.4 species of life by the process of gradual evolution. And the human form of life is spoiled for those conceited fools who do not take shelter of the lotus feet of Govinda or Krishna. So in other words, this verse explains that how human life is very, very important, and it's very, very rare. And it comes to us after a very unimaginable amount of time. So anything we get in life, which is very difficult to obtain and which takes a great amount of efforts, but we get it, and how much we cherish it. We keep it in the lock, we keep it in the locker, and we preserve it, and we are proud about it the whole time. So similarly, this human form of life is so rare and so difficult to obtain. So once obtained, it has to be used properly. Otherwise, it goes waste. And in the evolution of the soul, we are not guaranteed what kind of species we'll go into, depending on our karma. As Mataji explained the law of karma in great detail, we can be going anywhere. And so I now will a little bit speak about our cycle of coming and going within the human life. So we may not necessarily really fall down into, say, aquatics, unless we have done something extremely abominable. And most of us are not doing anything extremely abominable. So it's less likely that we will be going really down into the extremely lower species of life. But in general, in human beings, as Mataji explained, the goodness, passion, and ignorance, and they are, these modes of material nature are moving us up and down. And more or less, this verse in the Bhagavad Gita 9:21 speaks a little bit more about our journey as human beings going in that within our species of human race. We are going up and down heaven, earth, and hellish planets. So this verse is especially tetam bhuktva swargalokam vishalam chinya punya martilokam vishanti evam trayi dharmam anuprapanna gatagatam kama kama anubhante. So when they have thus enjoyed vast heavenly sense pleasure and the results of their pious activities are exhausted, they return to this mortal planet again. Thus those who seek sense enjoyment by adhering to the principles of the three Vedas achieve only repeated birth and death. I think someone was asking about the charity. So a charity which is in the mode of passion or even in the mode of goodness without understanding the service needed to the Supreme Lord in that charity will earn the piety. There will be a piety that you will earn by doing a great charity, but that piety will be exhausted one day because it's a material piety. And in this way, when our balance of this pious activities or the piety is exhausted, we have to return to the mortal world of earth. And sometimes it's so bad that we can also go down to the hellish planets. But those who do a great pious service to the humanity, but not necessarily in understanding the Supreme Personality of Godhead, for them, there is a place in the heavenly planets to just enjoy the senses. But this is the cycle of heavenly, the earthly, and the hellish planets. And Srila Prabhupada calls, in the purport of this particular verse 921, this cycle is the Ferris wheel. And this, it looks like this. We all have experience of this, going up and down. So journey from heaven to earth, to hell, and back to heaven. This can happen depending upon our karma, or depending on our mode of goodness, mode of passion, ignorance, we can just be continuing on earth, taking different types of births, different in different families, in different varieties of people. So it's a cycle, and we have to really understand the extent of this cycle that we just talked about right now. And Srila Prabhupada, he was speaking, and I'm going to read this because it's a little bit small font, and I don't know how much you can read. But in case of this particular verse, he was talking about urdhvam gacchanti sattvastha madhyam tishthanti rajasaha jaganya guna vrittistha adho gacchanti tamasa. So he was explaining about this exact process of evolution for humans as such, that there is a gradual process of evolution. So these are Prabhupada's words, gradual process of evolution. And the human form of life is the greatest evolution. And just put it down. Yeah. Here is a junction. Human form of life is a junction. Now you can go elevate yourself to further higher status of living condition. That is called devata or demigods. Urvam gacchanti sattvastha. If you develop the quality of goodness, then you are promoted to the higher planetary system. And madhya tishthanti rajasa. If you do not develop further, then you remain whatever quality you have got just now to remain within this world. And then adho gacchanti tamasa. And if you do not develop goodness or remain in the same quality, then you can degrade yourself. Then again, go back to the cycle of birth in the animal kingdom. So this is the law of nature. So Srila Prabhupada explains how wonderfully that we have a choice as a junction, or we can go any direction. So most of us have in the mode of passion, we take birth on earth again and again, but some of us who are really very pious, they can go to heaven. Some of us can go to hell. And some of us are, some of the human beings are so degraded that they can actually deny a human form of life, and they have to go back into some other species of life, which could be four-legged animals or snakes or anything like that. So for them, for those souls, you can imagine the evolution becomes a very, very lengthy process. For people like us, more or less, we have understanding, we are piety, we have some goodness, and we can somehow maintain, or we can go to heaven things like that. But still, it's a cycle. It's a cycle, and we are bound in this cycle. So when we do these seminars like Science of Self-Realization, there is a purpose of bringing to our attention of this cycle. Because this cycle is it's a serious problem. And we don't know about this problem unless we really become the students of the Gita and take the guidance of the Guru. Most of the times, even if we are brought up in a great Hindu religious family, sometimes it's not known very clearly that this cycle is a problem. Because going to the heavenly planets is one of the Vedic objectives that people follow. And they can be really be unaware of the problematic nature of the cycle for the spiritual evolution of the soul. As far as the body is concerned, it's fine. It's an enjoyment oriented journey towards heaven. But as far as the soul is concerned, as far as the spiritual evolution of the soul is concerned, this cycle is a problem. And that's why we want to focus on that in the science of self-realization, because we are realizing our own self. And that's how we are also trying to understand the journey of this self. So moving on, in this spiritual evolution, the concept of body and the soul has to be remembered. It has to be the basis of our lives, because it is explained with the help of this story that this woman who is taking care of the parrot, so-called taking care of the parrot, puts the parrot into the cage. And she is so much obsessed with taking care of the cage and polishing it and keeping it clean that she forgets about the parrot, who is a living person inside. And she forgets to feed this parrot, and the parrot dies. So what do you do with the cage? The parrot has died. So similarly, what has been explained, that we have to remember that inside this body, which we are enjoying very much, this is the soul. And if we don't remember that the soul is more important than the external body, and if we do not nourish the soul, if we do not do the activities which are giving nourishment to the soul, then we are taking care only of the body. And of course, the body is going to be vanished one day, and our spiritual evolution will come to a standstill, because then we haven't earned anything. We are not going anywhere. We probably will go to a higher enjoyment, or we may go to a lower enjoyment, or we may stay there. But nothing in terms of evolution of the soul. And that's why it's important that we have to remember this concept of life has to be based on the soul and the body, of the soul. So spiritual evolution, I would like to use these terms, art of living and art of dying, because that is going to help us with our spiritual evolution. And let's see in more detail what happens, or how do we do this art of living and then art of dying. So my point here is not necessarily about the spiritual evolution from earth to heaven, or even the spiritual evolution of the animal species as we saw before. My emphasis here is the spiritual evolution in my own life, here and now. Because otherwise it can become a little bit theory, and we understand that, oh yes, the soul moves in this way and this is, what impact does it make on my life? Can you help me with that? So we are going to see how we can use that here and now. So Bhagavad Gita is considered as a great guidebook for our spiritual evolution. That has to be 100% known. There is so much of knowledge that people can use for speech, and Prabhupada has given us that. So spiritual evolution, and this is just a summary slide. Spiritual evolution is essentially a change in our consciousness of who we really are and what is really of value. And in our multi-life journey of evolution, how we live and how we die decides the future path of evolution. So we'll just focus, we'll just reflect a few things on these topics. Spiritual evolution in my life here and now, I have divided into three. Find the meaning, find the purpose, and then live by the meaning and the purpose that we have found out. So let's see a little bit in more detail. So let's focus on the meaning first. Bhagavad Gita, in one sense, reflects a very dark picture of this material world. 8.15, the verse mentions Dukkhalem Ashashvatam. This world is temporary and miserable. And there is so much discussion in the Gita about the distress of life, the suffering and the death, and all. Sometimes it could be really a very gloomy picture. But Bhagavad Gita teaches about a daring possibility of a unique perspective on life, right? We have seen that to some extent in the in the previous session, as well as yesterday, day before, how this is a very unique possibility of a very different kind of perspective on life. And that is exactly finding the meaning of who we are. So Bhagavad Gita helps us find a different meaning in life and in death. There's a spelling mistake there, but that's okay. And when we are engaged, while we are living our own lives, in finding what is the deeper meaning of our life and what is the deeper meaning of death, then this becomes the greatest welfare work for ourselves, first of all for ourselves. And when I can do my own welfare, then I can also help others, my loved ones or my friends and family or my community. So it is suggested in the Gita that each good and bad experience, whether it is enjoyable or miserable, can help us evolve. Because remember, the previous slide, if we go, we are talking about spiritual evolution and we are finding the meaning. So in this meaning, all these experiences of life, they can help us to evolve. And we'll see a little bit in detail how it happens. So sometimes the good experiences, say we have new children arriving in our families, childbirth. That is a wonderful experience. But looking at that process and having an infant with such a tiny body, but at the same time having the mind and all these faculties, we can be amazed at the system of life, and we can meditate upon the spirit soul, and we can meditate upon the spiritual evolution. And the bad experiences, when the death happens, you know, the person is gone, that also this experience can help us evolve. And in this way, every kind of experience can help us evolve in our own spiritual journey. So when Bhagavad Gita explains the destructibility of the bodies, you know, it speaks about the death and some very, very hard facts of life. But all those things are already meaningless in one sense for us, because we already know that. That is known to even ordinary people, and people struggle so much with that destructibility, and they do not understand why and how this happens, and life seems meaningless. And that's why people have so many questions. That's why people have mental health problems, because they do not understand the meaning. But in the Gita, as we saw so far, the indestructibility of the soul can become the foundation for our search for meaning. And even in bad happening, we can pursue spiritual evolution and therein find the meaning. So as I mentioned before, remembering the concept of soul in the body is important, because here is our chance to understand the nature of the soul and as a part of Krishna and eternally separated fragmental part and parcel of Krishna. And knowing the journey of the soul so far, as we have discussed, or in the previous sessions we have discussed, we can pursue a great meaning in that. And as we meditate and as we contemplate upon this meaning of who we are as souls and how as souls and how we are moving, there is a great chance to evolve our own consciousness in terms of spirituality. So this is the meaning making. The other one is to find the purpose. So bad situations, you know, good situations, we are fine, but when the situations are not so good, the only thing that can work is our consciousness, because that is something that remains in our control all the time. I don't know how much time we have. We have another 15 minutes. So our consciousness is something that is still in our control, because we have a human body and we have much sophisticated facility to manage that consciousness as compared to other species of life. So this consciousness can be seen as a resource. Rather, it's the most important resource that will allow us to use all other resources of our body in terms of body, mind, intelligence. Here comes the bhakti practices. So the bhakti practice that is recommended by Srila Prabhupada, he has given us a package of what to do and how to do. So this bhakti practice, when it's done in the association of devotees, and we all know bhakti practice, chanting the holy names of the Lord, reading from the scripture, Bhagavad Gita and other books of Srila Prabhupada, and associating with devotees. What happens is that strengthens our consciousness. And once our consciousness is strengthened, because we have found the meaning of in the previous step, as we saw, we know we are the spirit soul part of Krishna, and we are on this journey. And I have this consciousness in my human body, and I'm doing all this sadhana bhakti with the help of devotees' encouragement. All of this will help us to move in our difficult times, move with strength, move with preparation and determination in our difficult times. And it's very easy again to just pick up on the Gita and say, Bhagavad Gita speaks only about karma, that my bad karma is putting me in this bad situation. So people can be really demotivated, and they can really feel meaningless if over and over again, they are bombarded with this idea of karma, bad karma. You did this and you suffer it. So sometimes it can be used in a very negative way. And people can really run away from this idea that I did this and that's why I'm to suffer. And they will ask so many questions about God and suffering and everything. But what the idea here is that instead of pointing fingers on karma, and sometimes people point onto other people's karma, like you did this, so you must have done something bad. So instead of doing that, we can deliberate how to respond effectively to our bad situations or difficult situations. So that's how, when bad things happen, good people do this. And in this whole process, we will discover our purpose. We will discover not only the strength to deal with the difficult time, but we will discover why the difficult time is coming on me and how do I deal with that. And Mahabharata is a great history, Vedic history, where most of these great personalities on Pandava's side, they have actually done this. So we have great illustrations of how this happens. When good people are facing difficult times, what do they do? We have Kunti Devi, we have Pandavas, we have amazing examples from Mahabharata. We can apply that in our own lives. That's the whole reason why Mahabharata is there, that I discover the purpose of my life, I discover the purpose of my difficult situation, why it has come, and I discover what I'm supposed to do. What do I do? And this can happen only through the connection through the bhakti process, through the sadhana bhakti. Because otherwise, it will be difficult. It will not be easy. Rather, we'll have to do some other yoga system in order to understand the meaning and the purpose, but that's something not recommended by Krishna for Arjuna and for people like us. We have to follow this sadhana bhakti, and in that way, try to progress in these two steps of meaning and purpose. Now, moving on to the living. So live by meaning and purpose. Now, remember, we are doing this for our own spiritual evolution. So we have understood the meaning of who we are. We have understood the purpose of my life and the difficult situations of my life. And now, how do I live? So how do I live? When we have come up to this point, we are in harmony with Krishna, or we should be in harmony with Krishna. So our Paramatma who is sitting in my heart is my guide. And when more and more bhakti practice is done, we develop a service attitude towards Krishna. And practicing this, sadhana bhakti, Krishna has given so much of promise in the Bhagavad Gita. There are so many promises, and each promise is Krishna's promise, so it doesn't go, doesn't fail like any other promise by people, by our relatives, by our friends, by our beloved people. Like, there's so many promises people give, but our politicians, the promises are not necessarily valid, but here are Krishna's promises and they are never failed. So here is a beautiful promise that Krishna gives, and that's verse 10 from chapter 10. Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayante. So to those who are constantly devoted to serving me with love, I give them the understanding by which they can come to me. And this is the guidance from within the heart, and also this guidance and help and the mercy comes from without. From without means from outside, from without, outside my heart. So one is the guidance from within the heart, which Paramatma gives, and one is the guidance and the direction Paramatma gives by sending the right people on your path. And that happens. And that has happened with all of these devotees who are in our congregation, who practice, who have been practicing sadhana bhakti, as I said, accompanied by service attitude, they are doing sadhana bhakti. And they have realized this promise of Krishna in their lives, that the guidance comes from within and the guidance comes from outside at every step in their lives. And while doing this, Krishna has promised that this is going to be easy for you. It is going to be enjoyable for you. In the 9th chapter, 2nd verse, he says, Pratyaksha avagamam dharmyam susukham kartum avyayam. He says that this is the knowledge, just not the knowledge, but a realization. And I'll give you the direct experience of it. I'll give you direct perception of the self by realization. This is everlasting and is joyfully performed. So this is how we can live. We can live in harmony with the Lord's instructions, following sadhana bhakti, understanding the meaning of who we are, understanding the purpose of our life and the purpose of our difficulties and how to face them. And while we do this with the help of bhakti, all we get is joy. All we get is the guidance from the Lord. All we get is the experience that Krishna is with me in my difficult times. And how Krishna is mercy and grace he's giving me. But to really go into more specific theory, I would request you to go to the 12th chapter, because that's, I have given a title to that, Art of Living Here and Now, where Krishna is giving a very step-by-step plan for a person to actually implement the meaning and the purpose of his life, which he has discovered or she has discovered with the help of sadhana bhakti. And there is a place for everybody. At whatever stage you are, there will be a matching instruction for you. So you don't have to feel intimidated that how can I just fix my mind and intelligence 24/7 on Krishna, which is the first point, which is here. No worries if you can't do that. And I promise, I accept that I don't do that. I cannot do that. I'm not at that level. And most of the sadhana bhakta, sadhana practicing devotees can say that we can't do that. So there's Krishna's instruction, one step lower, follow the regulations of bhakti yoga. And as I mentioned before, these are the instructions given by Srila Prabhupada as a package. He has given this package, you just take it and you just implement it. Just follow the basic instructions and you will be actually doing bhakti yoga. If you can't do that, or if you 100% not there, side by side work for Krishna. Use your intelligence, use your faculties, use your hobbies, inclinations to find the opportunities in the temple or in the broader world of Krishna consciousness, like ISKCON. There will be so many opportunities online, in other different ways, where you don't have to live next to the temple. You can still work for Krishna. And if you need guidance on that, you can contact me later on. And even if you don't do that, then Krishna says, just begin in a step-by-step by detaching from the results of your work, offering the results back to Krishna in sacrifice. If you're not ready for that, sit down and gain spiritual knowledge or meditate. So these are the wonderful plans Krishna has given for everybody's fit, liking and capacity. So in this way, the art of living, put Krishna in the center and you will make peace and happiness. This is the package of Bhakti Yoga. We chant the holy names of Krishna, the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. We read the Bhagavad Gita and all the books of Srila Prabhupada. We attend temple programs and we eat prasadam. And that's the crux of Bhakti Yoga, the art of living. Now, especially paying attention to this very practical instruction of the Gita or Krishna for people like us. Tasmat sarveshu kaleshu mam anusmara yudhya mayarbita mano buddhir mame vaishyasi asamshayaha. Arjuna was fighting, so he was given that mam anusmara yudhya. But sometimes our lives feel as good as a yuddha, you know, as good as a war. And whether it is as difficult as war or not so difficult as war, in any case, what is recommended that we carry on our lives, the prescribed duties, while thinking of Krishna at the same time. So this is a parallel path. And this is also an art of living where there will be an external execution of your prescribed duties, bodily, whatever is required, earning money for the family, maintaining the kids, and internally remembering Krishna, thinking of Krishna, surrendering to him, making him the real enjoyer and the real owner of everything that we have. So this is devotional service. So you can imagine, you can understand these two words, devotional service. So devotion is something internal. You know, you cannot do something externally to show the devotion. You do externally by way of service. So devotion is internal and service is external. And that's how this verse is something we can carry every day in our hearts. And this is how you get the freedom from karma, because we are keeping Krishna in the center. And as you can see, there are two people. They're doing the same exact activity. One is a soldier. He's killing the people on behalf of a government war. So he's authorized. He is qualified. And he's instructed to kill people, because there's a need to protect the land and the government has put him in that position. So he's doing everything on behalf of government. And for killing, he's given a reward. He's glorified. And on the other hand, a terrorist who acts whimsically for his own pleasure, for his own plans, for his own agenda, and which is completely whimsical and not moral and civilized, that person doing the same activity will suffer so much because he's not doing it in an authorized way. He's not qualified. So this is our position. We do, if we are unaware of Krishna, if we are unaware of this Vedic framework which is given to us, and we whimsically try to gain happiness by whatever ways. I mean, everybody has their own ideas, but we will not be peaceful and happy. We will suffer and we will be completely bewildered because of the things that fall on us. We try to gain the happiness and we gain it and then we lose it and then the misery comes. And we completely bewildered because we have no meaning. We have no purpose and we don't know how to live by anything. So that is the condition of some of the people in this world who are not following God consciousness. And if we want to get out of that, we can begin the devotional service acting on behalf of Krishna by the instructions and guidance of Guru. And in that way, we are not bound by whatever happens. If we are doing a job, we have to do certain things. We are earning money, but we are not bound by karma because we are putting Krishna in the center and doing all the devotional sadhana bhakti as recommended. So this is how there is a way to get freedom from karma. And there's a reward. As I said before, Krishna has many promises in the Gita for our care, our protection, for our peace and happiness. And one of the promises that I really like to present here is the verse 22 from chapter 9. Ananyaschintayanto mam yejanaha paripasate tesham nityabhyuktanam yogakshemam vahamyaham. But those who are always worship me with exclusive devotion, meditating on my transcendental form, to them I carry what they lack and I preserve what they have. So this can be really a transforming information where Krishna will carry what I lack and Krishna will preserve what I already have. In this way, he will give me care and protection, and that way I can be really peaceful and happy in this world. So this is the art of living, and art of living will follow art of dying. Because it is said that one's thoughts, in the Bhagavad Gita, it said that one's thoughts during the course of one's lifetime accumulate to influence one's thoughts at the moment of death. So the way we lead our present life is going to decide our next life. And that's why we have to always think of Krishna and never forget Krishna. And here is the promise again, especially for the art of dying. Antakale cha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram ya prayati samad bhavan yati nastastu samshaya. And whoever, at the end of his life, quits his body, remembering me alone, Krishna says, at once attains my nature, and of this there is no doubt, because it's Krishna's promise. So at the end, in conclusion, by seeing our sincerity in serving Krishna, Krishna gives his remembrance at the time of death. And this is a special mercy. So even if our senses are falling, our mind is falling, Krishna will appear in our mind. And in that way, he will make us remember him. That's a special mercy. So we should tolerate all the impediments in spiritual life and continue to chant Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Rama Ram, Hare Hare. And have the full benefit of Krishna consciousness in the art of living and the art of dying and in full liberation from karma. In this way, I glorify Srila Prabhupada at the end for thanking our dear Srila Prabhupada for opening our eyes with the torchlight Bhagavad Gita as it is. And that is our small offering for glorification of this Gita Jayanti that's coming. And thank you very much. We appreciate your patience and your opportunity that you have given me. And so I'll stop sharing my screen. Any comments, any thing that you feel you could recommend to my...
Sorry, Mataji. Go ahead, please. After that, I have question for Mataji.
Who is that?
That is Ashesha Karana Jagannath, Mataji.
Please go ahead.
Yes, so Mataji, consciousness, what is the relation between the soul and consciousness? And what is there in bad consciousness, good consciousness? Wow, how this affects the soul, and what is that? Can you give some clear idea about the consciousness and soul.
So the subtle body and the gross body is connected through our pranavayu, prana, the life air. And our subtle body is connected to our soul through consciousness. When we have a good consciousness, our subtle body will work accordingly. And we have a bad consciousness, the subtle body or the mind intelligence doesn't work properly. So basically, the soul and the subtle body are connected with consciousness, and it could be good or bad.
No, but means that this is a subtle body and soul. In between that, there is a medium of the medium is the consciousness or something like that, or what is that?
Yes, because
and that is
the subtle world. Our consciousness is different. In the spiritual world, our consciousness is Krishna is the center of attraction, and he is the enjoyer, and I am in exclusive service of Krishna, and I do not need to work for my own happiness, because if I give Krishna happiness, then I am happy. That is the idea, that is the consciousness of the soul in the spiritual world, that you can call as a good consciousness. But when the soul is in the material world, in different bodies, the soul's consciousness is contaminated, or you can say covered, by the material energy or illusory energy maya of the Lord, by which the soul's consciousness is impacted, and there is a need for the soul to start searching the happiness in this world. So the subtle body comes into the picture, and in the contaminated consciousness, your mind, intelligence, ego thinks that I need to find my own happiness. So where is the happiness? So there's a whole life we search. So that is the contaminated consciousness, or you can say bad consciousness. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. No, yeah, I understood, Mataji. You are clearly explained this thing. My question is that this consciousness, we know the subtle body and everything is the material thing. Subtle body is also material, mind, intelligence, and ego also material. But consciousness is material, or there is this is a element or something like that, or what is that?
Well, it's not an element. I mean, it's not a something that can be seen, because just like my mind, I cannot see my consciousness, but it's seen in the symptoms. It's seen by the symptoms. So consciousness is not something that we acquire in this material world. So it's not a material element, because it's already there in the spiritual world. We have consciousness as a soul, but contaminated. It's like they give the example of the contamination. You know, say if something, if you have an object, it falls down into oil, it becomes oily because that it is contaminated. But when you take it out and clean it, it's clean. So like that, the soul has a consciousness. It's pure consciousness. It's called Vasudeva Tattva in the spiritual world. But when we fall down, it's contaminated because it's falling down into the illusory energy of the Lord. And that's how we start seeing things differently. So basically, consciousness is not something that you can actually, it's not an element. What is it?
Yes.
The answer.
Yeah. Govindanandi Mataji?
Yes.
Shall I a little bit? Yeah, a soul has a symptom of thinking, feeling, and willing. Even the soul is in the material world or it goes back to the spiritual world, this feeling, willing, and thinking will be there. You can say, you can think like that, Prabhuji, that the symptom of that soul, this thinking, feeling, and willing is the consciousness.
Okay, that means soul has some property in spiritual as well. Some property is there. That is the thinking, feeling, and that is the consciousness.
Correct. The symptom. The symptom of the soul is consciousness.
But the question is that in spiritual world, our body is spiritual also. We have the body, spiritual body, and spiritual mind, everything. And our consciousness also is the spiritual element, this is actually a spiritual element, or what is that actually?
No, it's not mind. Mind, intelligence, false ego, all these are all the materialistic only. Consciousness is separate. It is the symptom. It is the, even the spiritual entities, the even in the spiritual world, the grass has this thinking, feeling, and willing. Garland has, rope has, pot has. So these symptoms are there. So they will be always glorifying each other, the serving nature of other devotees. So that is the nature of the soul, Prabhuji. Consciousness is that nature, the symptom.
Okay. Got it, Mataji. Okay. At least I got some clear idea. And is it correct that in the spiritual world we have the spiritual body, mind, spiritual mind, and everything?
It's not spiritual mind, but spiritual body will be there. There will not be two separate like in the material world. There is no gross, no subtle, nothing like that. Everything is only one, that is the spiritual body. Sachid Ananda Vigraha.
Yes, so let me just add something as you, Proji, you asked specifically that yes, we have the spiritual consciousness in the spiritual body. I think you're asking about that. So the answer is yes.
Okay. Got it. Thank you, Mataji. Very.
Thank you.
Explained very, very clearly. Thank you, Mataji. Dhanavad Pranam.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you so much for your, explanation, and it's very clear. So I have a question. So I see in one of your slides you are mentioning meditating in the transcendental form of the Supreme Lord. So I always have this question, when I meditate, how do I see the Supreme Lord as a Shyam Sundar form, or what is the right way of approaching the Lord?
So the idea Prabhupada has given that we don't try to see anything when we are chanting, because one time one devotee asked Srila Prabhupada, when I sit down and meditate, I see a yellow light. And Prabhupada said that focus on the chanting and the light will go away. So the idea is that we don't try to see anything, but we just follow the process of hearing and chanting. It's explained that the form will appear and very naturally in your meditation. And we don't have to struggle to look at the form.
Okay. Thank you, Mataji.
People can share something about their experiences around this topic of this presentation.
So I have one more question, Mataji, from the previous presentation Mataji had. It was said that we have to offer the bhojan to the Lord before we consume, right? But in the real family where we have the kids and all those things, sometimes we start preparing food in the morning, for the kids, in the hurry, and then even before taking baths and all those things, in a typical life. So when we do, when you make the food even before we take bath and all those things, is that time also is applicable that we can offer to the Lord, or it's not advisable to offer to the Lord when we don't take bath and prepare food?
Very nice, Prabhuji. It will be good. It is suggested and it is recommended to take bath and cook. But as I said, devotional service is the gradual process. You begin at certain point. You cannot offer to the deities, but you keep a picture in your kitchen and Gauranitai picture, and you offer to that, and you can have it.
Oh, thank you so much, Mataji.
Mataji, I have a question. Hare Krishna. So it's regarding karma. In a couple of slides, I mean, we discussed that karma is like whatever we do here, we get punished or we get the fruits out of that. I mean, so basically in this life only, bad karma and good karma has a result here. So there is no like kind of a balance at the end of the life that karma is going to carry forward, right, into the next life or next reincarnation. And on the same topic, so we don't know where we are come, we came from our previous life, and we will not know where we are going to go in the next life. How this 8.4 million species that evolution is going to determine, because our karma at the end of the life is going to be zero, right? I mean, balance will be kind of a zero. So how the next life will be determined?
When you unless you add Krishna in our life, we cannot bring that bad karma and good karma to zero, Prabhuji. Only when there is Krishna in our action only it is possible to bring it to zero.
Only I mentioned this verse that Srila Prabhupada mentions in the purport. Aprarabdham phalam papam kutam bijam phalonukam krameneiva praliyata vishnu bhakti ratatmanam. So I think you were asking about this whole balance and how this accounting of the balance works. Is that
mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm talking about like karma bank coming here. I mean, and
this is what is explained, that we have a very huge baggage of karma, and some of it is stored in such a way that is, you know, they give the example of the farmer. So the farmer has seeds, but the farmer puts them into storage, and the seeds will be used after 5 years, 10 years, whenever needed. So some of our karma is like that. It's stored in such a way that it just doesn't appear. And then just like the farmer takes those seeds and he puts them in the ground, and they are in the process of fructifying. So similarly, some of our karma is in that process, and some of the seeds will fructify and they'll have the growing sprout and they will have the fruit. So some of karma, it is called prarabdha, which is already appearing in our lives. So this whole accounting is done by the higher authority, karmana daiva netrena. And we have really no understanding of this accounting of our karma. Basically, we don't realize as to which karma Krishna gave in this life to appear and how is the combination he's doing. So, but the only idea is that there is some good and some bad Krishna gives, so that the person, the living entity, can survive. Because if I get too much of good or too much of bad, I will not be able to survive. So Krishna makes sure that we get a balance of these little good and little bad, and that's how it works. But practically speaking, we have no. It's fathomless. We can't understand how much big baggage and what's the accounting. Is that something that you
asked? Yes. So if I consider that, okay, forget about accounting of bad karma and good karma, but at the end of the slide, I think your presentation, there was something that mentioned that just continue devotional services or devotional, I mean, bhakti, and then liberated from the karma. So right. it basically kind of don't count yourself as in the kind of a karma bank or anything in terms of pressurizing or putting stress on your kind of services or in terms of your daily material life. I mean, so continue what you do, but do it at the best, and then continue doing bhakti or devotional services and along with your material life be liberated. That's what I think message is.
Because the last line of this verse, it says krameneiva praliyata vishnu bhakti ratatmanam. So when we take up Krishna bhakti, gradually these karmic reactions are nullified, or they are forfeited. They are Krishna cancels them. So only prarabdha karma is something which is immediately happening in my life. I will have to bear because that cannot be miraculously rectified by Krishna. but something that has that might come up after 5 years, 10 years, or in the next life, Krishna can verify that, and krameneva, gradually, and in that order. So some of the karma which is really stored in my silo, or they say the storage, that can disappear by Krishna's mercy because of the sadhana bhakti that I'm following. So there is a great hope that actually my karma path is changing because of Krishna bhakti, because of this verse explains that. And primarily we don't fall into that anxiety about our karma. Whatever is sent by Krishna, we don't know what combination is sent, but we have this guarantee that for bhaktas, he will reduce the karma substantially. And that's
thank you, Mataji. Yeah. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. You have beautifully covered the question, answer for this question. So, Saket Prabhu, in tomorrow's session, I will talk about different types of sins and how to get out of all the sins and what are the different types of sins that will happen. So since there are different types of sins, like Mataji quoted that verse, I'm going to talk about that, okay? So
okay, sure.
Tomorrow you'll get to know a little more about that. They have Mataji already beautifully covered it, but I'll just add a little more on that.
Sure.
Thank you, Mataji. Mataji, can you explain this? You touched upon this beautiful verse, aprarabdha. And this has different terms: aprarabdha karma, prarabdha karma, kutam, and bijam.
Okay.
Can explain those terms, Mataji?
Yeah. So, aprarabdha is something which is unmanifest. And as I said, the farmer's seeds is the best example to understand. So kutam means pile. It's kutam means pile. So as the farmer, he's putting the seeds in the pile in some other storage. So they have no fructification. There's no chance of sprouting out. So some of our karma in the beginning is mentioned in the verse that aprarabdha phalam, phalam papam, kutam. Kutam is the piling. And then bijam. So when the farmer has the rainy season, the right type of ground, he puts the bija in the ground. So some of these karmas are on the way, they're coming. Just like the bija can get sprouted at any moment. But some of these karma are given to us that will happen. And the next one is kutam, bijam, and phalam. And as the seed gets sprouted, you see the result. So some of these karma, which has not just bija form, but it has actually taken the sprout form, has manifested in my life. And that's how these are aprarabdha. The ones that are not sprouted are aprarabdha, but when it's sprouted, when it's manifest in my life, is called prarabdha. So this verse promises that the aprarabdha karma, which is yet to manifest, can be rectified by Krishna because we are taking the Krishna Bhakti path or Vishnu Bhakti path. So, krameneva praliyeta Vishnu Bhakti ratatmana. But the prarabdha karma is something which is, we have to suffer. There is no, I mean, honestly, as a devotee, we do not appeal or petition Krishna that miraculously just take away my prarabdha karma, which is already manifest in my life. The devotees very honestly accept that yes, this is the manifested karma in my life, and let me just go through that, but at the same time, let me continue my devotional service. And there is the verse Tatya Anukampam Susamikshmano. It's a very nice verse. The Bhagavatam, 10th canto, 14th chapter, verse number 8. Tatya Anukampam Susamikshmano, Bunjana Vatmakutam Vipakam, Rudvaka Vapurbir Vidhana Namaste, Jiveta Yo Mukti Padis Daivak. Which means in this way, the prarabdha karma, which is already manifested, I honestly bear it. And at the same time, with my mind, body, and senses, I continue Krishna Bhakti. And in that way, I become eligible for liberation. So this is the aprarabdha, which is rectified by Krishna. And the prarabdha, there is also a way to rectify by taking Krishna bhakti. So I think this is what my understanding, Puji. Mataji, if you want to add something, please do.
Hare Krishna, Mataji, Haribo. Mataji, you mentioning that Prabhupada mentioned that shloka in Purport?
Yes. Prarabdham phalam papam?
Yes. And which text is that, Mataji?
Okay, so I'll have to look into the index. I can.
I'm sorry.
I can text you.
Nectar of devotion.
Huh?
No, Nectar of devotion.
It's from Nectar of devotion.
Yeah, but
original verse is from Padma Purana, and it is quoted in Nectar of Devotion.
Okay, but I think Prabhuji wants to have a reference from the Gita, right? One second, I can give you a prarabdham. I can drop that. I don't remember the exact verse. I'm sorry. I can't remember the purport, but I can look at it later on.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you for such nice explanation. I also wanted to add, I heard in one of the lecture of His Holiness Bhakti Charu Swami Guru Maharaj that in order to accumulate goodness, good karma, another way is that mentally also we can accumulate it. In the sense that if we mentally we whatever we offer or whatever devotional service we are doing, then that will also add to our devotional service and our karma. However, he also explained that that does not mean that one should take an advantage. And the example he gave was that if, for example, we want to offer some Lakshmi, but we are in such a situation that we are not able to, but mentally, if we think and we offer, then it is considered as good as we are offering physically. But then it does not apply to a person who's like a billionaire and who still offers mentally and he's not offering, whereas his capability is to offer. So it does not apply there. If he has, then he should offer. Which means like one should not take advantage. And this is the advantage, benefit of the Kali Yuga that it adds to our devotional service. But at the same time, if we are mentally, we are thinking of any bad deed, then that will not add to until and unless we are physically, we do that. So which means the good deed adds even if we are doing mentally.
Yes, thank you for adding that.
Hare Krishna. Also, Mataji, that verse is from Bhagavad Gita 9th chapter, 2nd verse, purport.
Thank you.
Of Prarabdha Phalam Kutam. 9.9.2.
Yeah.
Mataji, again, I have another question, Mataji.
Yes.
So karma is due to consciousness or something like that. So karma comes, the action is come after the consciousness, right? Our consciousness is bad and doing some bad work like that. Or what is the sequence?
Yes. Yeah, so I will try and then Mataji can add something. So as I mentioned, the contamination. Contaminated consciousness has these tools that you have. The mind is the tool. Subtle body is the tool. And Srila Prabhupada mentions in the introduction that all the action that actually we take with our hands and legs happens at the mental level first. So you see there's a contamination in the consciousness. And with that contaminated consciousness, which affects your subtle body, And your mental plane is doing all these plans for a bad action or a good action. And then you actually go and actually do it with your hands and legs. So this is the sequence. But Vaman Mataji, please add anything.
No, that's good. Yeah, as it is explained in the one of the charts, in the material world, living entity, when it is subjected to or going through these three modes of material nature, the perceptions will vary and it will lead to the emotions and it will lead to the actions. So it will be materialized in terms of actions. So we should be very careful what consciousness we are taking, and we should stay always according to the scriptures. We should stay always in the spiritual consciousness, so that we will be away from all this.
So consciousness is taking means you are talking about the Mataji. Consciousness you are taking means something which is taking from outside.
Yes. So, and consciousness is within us, and it is affected by the atmosphere, affected by the association we are taking.
Okay.
When it is desiring to lord it over material nature, to lord over material nature, to enjoy, to be independent enjoyer, so then the consciousness will make according to the karma accordingly.
Okay, got it. Thank you. Well explained, Mataji.
Okay. Thank you very much, Govindanandani Mataji and Kalindi Gopikanta Mataji. So, wonderful session.
Thank you very much for giving us the opportunity, Prabhuji. And your slides are very helpful. And I took a lot of content also. Thank you so much for your time and help towards these presentations.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Govindanandani Mataji also covered wonderful topics, and especially these words which I was thinking about. Yep. So, again, this was day 4 of our discussion on the 6th session course on the science of self-realization, on the essence of Bhagavad Gita. Tomorrow we'll be discussing on what is yoga, right? And ultimately, various types of yoga, the yogic ladder, culminating into Bhakti Yoga and details of Bhakti Yoga. That will be covered tomorrow by Hari Kishore Prabhu and Akhilesh Krishna Prabhu. So that's day 5, and day 6th on Thursday. That okay, we learned all these wonderful concepts. How are we going to practically apply in our day-to-day life? That will be on day 6, which will be covered nicely by Dev Kirandan Prabhu and Hema Jagannath Prabhu on Thursday from 7 to 9. If any lingering questions you may still have, you can send us a text. We also have a WhatsApp group, Nityam Bhagavata Sevya, where you can post. Or if you're not part of that, please send us the question and we will try to answer those. Again, I would like to thank Govindanandani Mataji and Kalindi Gopikanta Priya Mataji with a loud Hari Bol.
Hari Bol.
Hari Bol. Hari Bol. Hari Bol. Hari Bol.
Hari Bol.
Okay, on that note, we'll offer our humble obeisances to all the assembled Vaishnavas as our thanks to attend this class.
Hari Bol. Hari Bol. Hari Bol.
Thank you for attending this class, and you are spending all this time because you're wonderful Vaishnavas, and we'd like to offer our obeisances the form vancha kalpatur vayascha
kripa sindhu bhi evacha
padinam
bhavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namah vaishnavabhyo ki jai.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.